So I apologize for distracting us. We were talking about Heidegger.
Okay.
That, and the reason we were distracted is he happened to also be a Nazi, but he nevertheless has a lot of powerful ideas. What are the ideas he's brought to the world?
Okay. So that's a big, huge question. So let me see how much of it I can get on the table. I mean, the big picture is that Heidegger thinks, and he's not really wrong to think this, that the whole history of philosophy from Plato forward, maybe even from the pre-Socratics forward, from like the 6th century BC to now, has been motivated by a certain kind, or has been grounded on a certain kind of assumption that it didn't have the right to make, and that it's led us astray, and that until we understand the way in which it's led us astray, we're not going to be able to get to grips with the condition we now find ourselves in. So let me start with what he thinks the condition we now find ourselves in is. Lots of periods to Heidegger's views. I'm just going to sort of mush it all together for the purposes of today. Heidegger thinks that one of the crucial things that we need to contend with when we think about what it is to be us now is that the right name for our age is a technological age. And what does it mean for our age to be a technological age? Well, it means that we have an understanding of what it is for anything at all to be at all that we never really chose, that's sort of animating the way we live our lives, that's animating our understanding of ourselves and everything else, that is quite limited. And it's organized around the idea that to be something is to be what's sitting there as an infinitely flexible reserve to be optimized and made efficient. And Heidegger thinks that that's not just the way we think of silicon circuits or, you know, the river, when we put a hydroelectric power plant on it, we're optimizing the flow of the river so that it makes energy, which is infinitely flexible and we can use in any way at all. It's the way we understand ourselves, too. We think of ourselves as this reserve of potential that needs to be made efficient and optimized. And when I talk with my students about it, I ask them, you know, like, what's your calendar look like? What's the goal of your day? Is it to get as many things into it as possible? Is it to feel like I've failed unless I've made my life so efficient that I'm doing this and this and this and this and this that I can't let things go by? The feeling that I think we all have that there's some pressure to do that, to relate to ourselves that way, is a clue to what Heidegger thinks the technological age is about. And he thinks that's different from every other age in history. We used to think of ourselves in the 17th century, at the beginning of the Enlightenment, as subjects who represent objects. Descartes thought that a subject is something, some mental sort of realm that represents the world in a certain way. And we are closed in on ourselves in the sense that we have a special relation to our representations. And that's what the realm of the subject is. But others, you know, in the Middle Ages, we were created in the image and likeness of God. And in the pre-Socratic age, to be was to be what whooshes up and lingers for a while and fades away. The paradigm of what is were thunderstorms and the anger of the gods, Achilles' battle fury, and it overtakes everything and stays for a while and then leaves, the flowers blooming in spring. And that's very different from the way we experience ourselves. And so the question is, what are we supposed to do in the face of that? Mm-hmm. And Heidegger thinks that the presupposition that's motivated everything from the pre-Socratics forward is that there is some entity that's the ground of the way we understand everything to be. For the Middle Ages, it was God. that was the entity that made things be the things that they are. For the Enlightenment, it was us. Maybe for Sartre, it's us. And Heidegger thinks whatever it is that stands at the ground of what we are, it's not another thing. It's not another entity. And we're relating to it in the wrong way if we think of it like that. There's some way, and this is partly why I was interested in Meister Eckhart. He says, what there is there's giving going on in the world. And we're the grateful recipient of it. And the giving is like, whatever it is, it's the social norms that we're thrown into. We didn't choose them. They were given to us.
And that's the ground.
That is what makes it possible for anything to be intelligible at all.
Okay.
If we lived outside of communities, if we lived in a world where there were no social norms at all, nothing would mean anything. Nothing would have any significance. Nothing would be regular in the way that things need to be regular in order for there to be departures or manifestations of that regularity. So community norms are crucial, but they're also always updating. We have some responsibility for what they are and the way in which they're updating themselves. And yet we didn't ever choose it to be that way. So those norms are somehow giving significance to us in a way that we're implicated in, we have some relation to. And all that gets covered over if you think of us as efficient resources to be optimized.